Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We are going to study who are apostles, prophets, and evangelists, and what are the gifts of the prophecy and the ministry of God. Churches say that an apostle is a sent person, sent by the church. Beyond this, there's no specifics given. So we may see them as missionaries from their church, but not as an apostle. Luke chapter 6, verses 12 and 13. Verse 12, and it came to pass in those days that he, Jesus, went out into the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer with God. He was praying to God the Father. Verse 13, and when it was day, he called unto him his disciples, and of them he chose 12, whom also he named apostles. Here, Jesus, after he prayed all night with God the Father, he promoted 12 of his disciples as apostles. Matthew chapter 10, verse 1 and 2 says, Jesus called unto him the 12 apostles, not all the disciples, just the 12. He gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sicknesses and all manner of diseases. So apostles are promoted disciples who had received power from God to heal and to do miracles. However, Satan may also show signs and wonders. And so the proof of a true apostle is that he must live the life of Jesus Christ and he must exhibit power. Prophets were called of God and to be the mouthpiece of God. And they could also exhibit power from God. In the Old Testament, they were placed above kings, yet many of them were killed by ungodly people. Most of them told prophecies, and most of the prophecies were fulfilled. And the rest of the prophecies are yet to be fulfilled. Some of them prophecies for the long durations. But there were so many called themselves our prophets, even the Old Testament, they were false prophets. There's plenty of them. In the New Testament, not many prophets are mentioned. In Acts chapter 3, verse 1, only six names are mentioned as prophets, and the name of Prophet Agabus is mentioned just twice, and I think that it could be because the prophecy is given to common believers as a gift of prophecy. Even though it is not mentioned, the office of the prophet still remains. It's not go away. The prophets are still here, but not plenty, very few in certain places only. Prophets are given to the body of Christ, as in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. They work toward perfecting the saints in the ministry and edifying the body of Christ. The gift of prophecy is entirely different from the office of the prophets. The Holy Ghost gives the ability to speak prophecy to believers and even to rebellious ones as a gift, so that God's presence may be with the people of God, as in the book of Psalms chapter 68 verse 18. In the Old Testament, God tells people what will happen in the future through prophecy. However, now, the present time, it is not exactly foretelling, but God reveals what is in the hearts of the people so that the name of God may be glorified. It is used as a ministry tool to edify the body of Christ. But false preachers use foretelling as the gift of prophecy to deceive and exploit people. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 24 and 25 say, if believers prophesy, if a new person come into the assembly of the church, and he will be judged by the believers, because they have the gift of prophecy, and they could prophesy, they could tell what the person has in their mind. And thus, the secret of the heart will be manifest, and so the person who came in will confess, or saying that your God is a true God and you worship God. This is how the New Testament prophecy should be done, and God's name will be glorified. Instead, false prophets prophets, I mean the preachers who give false prophecy, and they say something in their mind as prophecy, because of them the name of the Lord is often put to shame. The gift of prophecy may also work as the combination of gift of tongues and the gift of interpretation. They both joined together will give forth the prophecy. Believers may learn from the prophecy and they may be comforted by the prophecy. It is very important for the nourishment of the new church. However, even though the gift of prophecy is from God, it is only a guideline given through ordinary people to the body of Christ. So it will not be as perfect as the revealed word of God. So the gift of prophecy has limitations. It is inferior to the scripture. The evangelists venture into the field and their office is to perfect the church. That's what they do. That's the office of the evangelist. At present times, evangelists are floating preachers and who do not have their own church to minister. Church pastors help them so that they could preach in their churches. The Bible time evangelists were not that this way. These people depend on the pastors for their livelihood. The Bible evangelists, they ventured into the field and harvested for the Lord and established churches. For that, they worked in the ministry to edify and to perfect the church. They have a very important office. After the apostles, the second thing was evangelists. And the prophets are there, but evangelists go-getters. And however, much detail is not given about evangelists in the New Testament. 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 2 to 6 gives a good description about the work of the evangelist. Just before the departure of Apostle Paul, when he hands over the responsibility of the ministry to Timothy, he tells him to do the ministry of an evangelist. These verses say, what is the job chart of an evangelist? It involves preaching the truth and then to rebuke, reprove, and to exhort with doctrine. Paul tells him to endure affliction, which is the integral part of the ministry of an evangelist. Ministry is to serve God, but now it is a kind of reputable profession. Jesus has begun the ministry with his disciples. After his resurrection, Jesus Christ told his disciples to continue his ministry. The apostles has done so, and it is in the book of Acts, it is recorded in many places. The resurrected Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost stood with the ministry of the apostles. In Acts chapter 20, verse 24, but none of these things moves me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. It is Apostle Paul is writing. So he has received the ministry from the Lord Jesus Christ, and he was willing to give his life, willing to die for the ministry with joy. And as all the other apostles, they are also martyred. So they were very happy. The ministry is that is the ministry of the world. Ministers are servants of God, are apostles, are evangelists, are anybody. That is the kind of ministry at the time. 1 Corinthians chapter 16 verse 15 says, the house of Stephanas, he is the first fruit of Achaia, and they have their family, and Achaia, the house of the Achaia, and they have addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints. Here, Stephen died, and he was a martyr. The instead of mourning his death, his family was addicted to the ministry. They devoted, they gave themselves to the ministry. They did not mourn, and they are also willing to die. The saints and the followers of Jesus Christ also did the same thing. And the minute they received the ministry, they were willing to give their life for it. And but at the present day, the ministry is considered as a profitable and reputable profession. People in the ministry means they have a steady income and the fame and reputation, and they are well placed. But the true ministers of God is they suffered a lot. They were willing to die, but the thing is, it is an opportunity for them to be with God for eternity to come. That's the eternal benefit. And so, either way, the present day ministers, the ministry is glorious in the world, but not glorious for eternity. If we dedicate ourselves and give yourself to the ministry, and God will honor you in eternity. Thank you for listening. May God bless you and be with you. Amen.